I'm Doug Little, National Wild Turkey Federation's Director of Conservation Operations for the East Region. In summer of 2023, NWTF unveiled its Habitat for the Hatch initiative. The initiative covers an 18-state region in the Southeast, and it was born out of a lot of concerns for wild turkey numbers and turkey declines throughout the region. The goal of the initiative is to enhance 1 million acres over the course of the 10-year period. The acres that we improve will be focused on nesting and brood rearing habitat, which we feel are the most critical elements for wild turkey survival and reproduction throughout the region. NWTF will also invest in research. This research investment will help us understand how to more effectively and efficiently put wild turkey nesting and brood rearing habitat on the ground. We look forward to working with our state and federal agency partners, private landowners, our members, volunteers, other partners as well, to make sure that we're putting the best quality habitat on the ground for wild turkeys to nest and raise their broods. This is going to ensure that future generations are going to be able to enjoy the wild turkey.
Welcome to Tennessee. We're here at the Otey Mills Wildlife Refuge, which is part of the North Cumberland WMA. This WMA is about 205,000 acres and it's managed by the Tennessee Wildlife Resources Agency. They recently acquired some property from the Nature Conservancy and are working to restore an old cattle pasture for wildlife habitat. We're going to be taking a look at a lot of different practices today, from herbicide application, to prescribed fire, to managing in an open field setting, to managing in a closed canopy system. What we're gonna look at today is creating habitat for the hatch.
So in East Tennessee, we're up here in the Cumberland Mountain Range, and what we have a lot of is forest and old cattle fields. So trying to target wildlife management, especially, you know, turkeys and brood rearing habitat. It's important to try to utilize those openings and create the most ideal habitat for wildlife that we possibly can. Fescue ground makes it really hard for small animals such as turkey poults, quail, songbirds, rabbits, and small mammals and stuff like that to traverse the ground because it's so thick. So using herbicide application through different means, tractor, helicopter, can be a good way to neutralize and eradicate invasives such as fescue or sericea, lespedesia, or multifloral rose, and help reestablish those native foods that leave a little more open ground and more ideal habitat for multiple species of wildlife.
So from a brood rearing standpoint, these cool season grasses, like the tall fescue that we're dealing with on this property, they're not conducive to really helping those poults be successful and survive. Mostly because even though there's some good structure above it and plants that are beneficial to wildlife, when you get down on the ground level, it's such a thick mat that the poults really can't walk through it. They can't navigate it. And so that's the main reason they wanted to treat this area and try and remove a lot of that tall fescue, that understory, and really kind of open it up at ground level so that those poults can just actually move through it. It just becomes such a thick mat that they can't physically get through it.
When you're doing such things as converting, you know, fescue fields to native old field habitat, there's lots of tools in the toolbox, one of those being herbicide. Herbicide can be expensive, but another follow-up tool that is relatively inexpensive is fire. And I recommend using the two in conjunction with each other. You'll get much better results.
Prescribed fire is really one of our single best management tools that we have. And there are a lot of opportunities to educate yourself about using prescribed fire as a management tool. Many states offer assistance with that. So I do work for the University of Tennessee Extension, And I just want to suggest that maybe you look into the various cooperative extension folks in your area and your county, and especially at our universities. So there's University of Tennessee, Mississippi State, University of Georgia, Texas A&M, NC State, lots of schools that have extension. And they're publishing amazing research, and they have lots of professionals that can help and guide you. But prescribed fire is cheap, and it's something that we can apply across a large landscape scale. And not only that, but prescribed fire is natural. So it's as important as the rain and the wind. So it's an important management tool that we need to start applying on a landscape where it naturally and historically occurred. Some folks are afraid to burn in hardwoods. So that's something that we are trying to encourage folks and educate folks on. And I will say that especially on some of these places, these southerly facing slopes, prescribed fire historically occurred in those places, and where we're creating those canopy gaps, we're getting more sunlight to the floor, and then we're applying typically low intensity fire. Then we're seeing a lot of native species, native warm season grasses, lots of native forbs and legumes, brambles, just a wide variety of species that are responding positively after those low intensity fires and creating sometimes a really lush understory. And that lush understory can be the hot spot. That's where that biodiversity occurs in these hardwood woodlands and savannas that we're now creating on a larger landscape.
Part of this property that we're on right now was owned by the Asher family. And in that, they ran a beef cattle production farm. And part of it in that the family quit raising cattle about 3 years ago. And through a cooperative effort between TWRA and the Tennessee Nature Conservancy, we were able to acquire this 800 acre tract. And they haven't had any cattle here for over 3 years. So you can imagine the fescue has been rampant. And in that, a lot of exotics have come into this area. This area of East Tennessee was known for its coal mining industry. And through the reclamation efforts, automotive was planted to hold the soil. So we have quite a bit of autumn olive. We have multiflora rose, as you might see to my left, that's coming in. And in that, with this dense fescue with these exotics, we realized we had a unique opportunity to affect this 800 tract, to set it back into early succession, which we're hoping will not only benefit the turkey that utilize this area to increase their population, but also there are also several biodiversity type species, some unique tropicals that come through here that will utilize this early succession, and also several small game species.
Depending upon the scale of your project, don't be intimidated by that. The property that we're on, we treated roughly 300 acres of old cattle pasture and then conducted a prescribed fire that was 381 acres. We used a helicopter for the aerial herbicide application, which can cover more ground than a tractor could spray, or maybe the ground is too rough for a tractor to traverse. So there are multiple tools such as helicopters, drones, tractors to help you get the job done. So whether you're managing an acre and you may use a tractor or maybe even a 3 gallon backpack sprayer to doing a couple hundred acres, there's always a perfect tool for the job.
What comes in after we've treated it, burned it, we're getting a lot of what we call these forbs, flowering plants. And the structure for them is great for poults because you end up with just kind of a single stem and then a lot of leaves that come out. So it creates like this umbrella almost, where they get the overhead cover that protects them from predators and overheating from the sun, gives them some shade. But those individual stems that are just sticking up out of the ground, it's easy for them to move through it underneath it and to bug, find the bugs that they're wanting to eat. So that's what we're really striving for when we talk about brood cover and brood habitat.
Here you can see behind me is a classic mixed hardwood stand. Typically in Tennessee, what we found on a wide variety of study sites, and of course visiting with landowners throughout the state, is most of the time you only have about 2 to 5% sunlight that hits the ground. And you can see that here. And as a result, you end up with closed canopy conditions and then mainly just leaf litter and shade tolerant plants kind of scattered about. So this is not good habitat conditions for wild turkey, as far as especially brood cover. And brood cover is really the limiting habitat type across the state. And one of the things that we really need to work on is having optimum habitat conditions that provide not only nesting cover, but then brood cover adjacent to that, so that turkeys don't have to go very far. And then turkey poult survival then will be increased as a result. And anyway, this is an exciting place because it is common, but we are really trying to start an initiative in Tennessee where we're going to allow more sunlight into these stands through active forest management. So if you have a stand like this, closed canopy conditions, there are a number of options, and one would be prescribed fire. That can be difficult though, because there's not enough airflow in here and it's so shaded that it's difficult to conduct prescribed burns in a situation like this. So also another thing is one fire is not going to do it. So it would take multiple prescribed burns across probably an 8 or 12 year time frame to really start making a difference. And what I mean by that is with prescribed burning, some of these thin bark species, especially the smaller hardwood species that are in the mid-story, you'll start to kill some of those over time. But prescribed fire is really not your best option. Other options would be logging. So timber harvest is a great opportunity to really open this stand up and then follow that up maybe with prescribed fire. Some of you landowners, maybe you don't have enough valuable timber to entice a logger to come to your property, or maybe you're not interested in that. So we are going to go through another practice that you can do even on your own, and that's hack and squirt, girdle and spray, or even going through and selectively felling some smaller trees on your own and using a cut stump treatment in some cases, depending on the species of tree that you're cutting, and then maybe even leaving some trees that will vigorously sprout that might provide good browse for white-tailed deer, but also decent cover, maybe nesting cover, or provide some of the structure needed for some young turkey poults.
You know, it's not the conversion that you're making or the habitat you're seeing may not happen overnight. It might take a year or 2 years of continuous management along with some follow-up. We may have to come out and spot spray some grasses that didn't get killed with the herbicide or didn't die with the fire. So it's a continual process, and as a manager, you should be constantly evaluating on the ground what vegetation you're seeing, what time of year you spray, what time of year that you burn. All that will make a difference as to what results that you do get.
If you're interested in learning more about Habitat for the Hatch and how the NWTF is working with our partners, not only in Tennessee, but across the region, please visit nwtf.org for more information.